Once upon a time, in a faraway land, a young prince lived in a shining castle. Although he had everything his heart desired, the prince was spoiled, selfish, and unkind. One winter's night, an old beggar woman came to the castle and offered him a single rose in return for shelter from the bitter cold. Repulsed by her haggard appearance, the prince sneered at the gift and turned the old woman away. But she warned him not to be deceived by appearances, for beauty is found within. And when he dismissed her again, the old woman's ugliness melted away to reveal a beautiful enchantress. The prince tried to apologize, but it was too late, for she had seen that there was no love in his heart. As punishment, she transformed him into a hideous beast and placed a powerful spell on the castle and all who lived there. Ashamed of his monstrous form, the beast concealed himself inside his castle with a magic mirror as his only window to the outside world. The rose she had offered was truly an enchanted rose, which would bloom until his 21st year. If he could learn to love another and earn their love in return, by the time the last petal fell, then the spell would be broken. If not, he would be doomed to remain a beast for all time. As the years passed, he fell into despair and lost all hope. For who could ever learn to love a beast? Across the countryside, not far from the beast's castle, an inventor lived with his daughter, Belle. Every morning, Belle left their cottage and hurried into town, swinging a book at her side. While she dreamed about castles and kings, she passed ordinary shops and cafes and the baker and everyone else in the village who had never met anyone quite like Belle.
Little town, it's a quiet village. Every day, like the one before. Little town, full of little people, waking up to the baker with his tray like always, the same old bread and rolls to sell. Every morning just the same, since the morning that we came to this poor provincial town.
Good morning, pal. Good
morning, monsieur.
Where are you off to?
The bookshop. I just finished the most wonderful story about a beanstalk and an ogre.
Oh, that's right. Marie! The baguettes! Hurry up!
Look, there she goes, the girl is strange, no question. Dazed and distracted, can't you tell?
Near the paws of any crowd,
was her handsome or some clown.
No denying she's a funny girl, that Belle.
Bonjour.
Good day.
How is your family?
Bonjour.
Good day.
How is your wife?
I need 6 eggs.
That's too expensive.
There must be more than this provincial life.
Ah, Belle.
Good morning. I've come to return the book I borrowed.
Finished already?
Oh, I couldn't put it down. Have you got anything new?
Not since yesterday.
That's all right. I'll borrow this one.
That one? But you've read it twice.
Well, it's my favorite. Far off places, daring sword fights, magic spells, a prince in disguise.
If you like it all that much, it's yours.
But, sir.
I insist.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Look, there she goes. That girl is so peculiar. I wonder if she's feeling well.
With a dreamy, far off look.
And her nose stuck in a book. What a puzzle to the rest of us is Belle.
She's nothing like the rest of us. Yes, different from the rest of us is Belle.
didn't miss a shot, Gaston. You're the greatest hunter in the whole world.
I know.
No beast alive stands a chance against you. And no girl for that matter.
It's true, Lifu. And I've got my sights set on that one.
Oh, the inventor's daughter?
She's the one. The lucky girl I'm going to marry.
But she...
The most beautiful girl in town.
I know, but...
That makes her the best. And don't I deserve the best?
Well, of course. I mean, you do, but...
Right from the moment when I met her, saw her, I said she's gorgeous and I fell. Here in town there's only she who is beautiful as me. So I'm making plans to woo and marry Belle.
Look there, he goes, isn't he dreaming? Monsieur Gaston, oh, he's so cute. He's still my heart, I'm hardly breathing. He's such a tall, dark, strong, and handsome
prince. Oh, sure, dog.
What a name you call this baby.
What a name
you call
this baby.
Excuse me.
I'll get the knife.
Please let me through.
His friends, his estates.
Heaven's estates.
There must be more in his coming tonight.
Just watch, I'm going to make Belle my wife.
Gaston took a shortcut, then posed nonchalantly in front of Belle.
Hello, Belle.
Bonjour, Gaston.
When she ignored him by continuing to read, he snatched the book out of her hands.
Gaston, may I have my book, please?
How can you read this? There's no pictures.
Well, some people use their imagination.
Belle, it's about time you got your head out of those books and paid attention to more important things. It's not right for a woman to read. Soon she starts getting ideas and thinking.
Gaston, you are positively primeval.
Thank you, Belle. What do you say you and me take a walk over to the tavern and take a look at my trophies?
Maybe some other time. I have to get home to help my father. Goodbye.
That crazy old loon, he needs all the help he can get.
Don't talk about my father that way.
Yeah, don't talk about her father that way.
LeFou winked at Gaston.
My father is not crazy. He's a genius.
Just then, a loud explosion came from the inventor's cottage. Belle whirled around and ran home, arriving in time to see the dust and debris settling around her father.
Papa?
How on earth did that happen?
Are you all right, Papa?
I'm about ready to give up on this hunk of junk.
You always say that.
I mean it this time. I'll never get this boneheaded contraption to work.
Yes, you will. And you'll win first prize at the fair tomorrow. And become a world-famous inventor.
You really believe that?
I always have.
Well, what are we waiting for? I'll have this thing fixed in no time. Hand me that dog-legged clincher there. So, did you have a good time in town today?
I got a new book. Papa, do you think I'm odd?
My daughter? Odd? Where would you get an idea like that?
Oh, I don't know. It's just that I'm not sure I fit in here. There's no one I can really talk to.
What about that Gaston? He's a handsome fella.
He's handsome, all right. And rude and conceited and... Oh, Papa, he's not for me.
Well, don't you worry, because this invention's gonna be the start of a new life for us.
Late that afternoon, Maurice piled his invention into a wagon. He asked Belle to help him hitch up their horse, Philippe, then waved goodbye and took off down the road. Soon the setting sun cast long, tapered shadows, and a chill wind snaked through the trees. Maurice pulled his coat around him, and both he and Philippe bent their heads toward the ground. The horse plodded on for miles, then suddenly halted. Maurice looked up. Somehow they had ventured into a bleak, misty forest. He tried to turn Philippe around, but a flock of bats whooshed past their heads and sent Philippe hurtling toward a cliff edge.
Whoa.
Terrified, Maurice pulled back on the reins, preventing them from going over the side.
Steady.
As Maurice tried to calm Philippe, they heard a low, savage growl. A wolf had found them. The horse reared, knocking Maurice to the ground.
Oh.
Then Philippe bolted into the darkness, with a wagon clattering behind him. Dazed, Maurice saw two yellow eyes staring through the mist.
Oh.
He picked himself off the ground and began running, rushing through the shrouded trees. Suddenly he glimpsed a tall, ornate gate. He grabbed the rusted bars and shook them violently.
Help! Is someone there? Help!
In desperation, Maurice pushed at the gate until it flew open. He tumbled inside, and the heavy bars slammed behind him. A monstrous castle jutted out of the mist. When no one answered the door, Maurice ventured inside.
Hello?
Is someone there? I don't mean to intrude, but I've lost my horse, and I need a place to stay for the night.
Of course, monsieur. You're welcome here.
Who said that?
Maurice felt someone tap his shoulder and found himself eye to eye with a talking candelabra.
Hello.
Incredible.
Well, now you've done it, Lumiere. Splendid. Just peachy.
Then he looked down and saw something extraordinary. A mantel clock waving stout little arms and wearing the most exasperated expression on its face. Maurice grabbed the mantel clock and pried open the door.
How is this accomplished?
Put me down at once. Stop that. Stop that, I say.
Sir, close that at once. Do you mind?
I beg your pardon. It's just that I've never seen it.
The candelabra led him into a drawing room and offered him a place in front of the fire.
Oh, you are soaked to the bone, monsieur. Come, warm yourself by the fire.
Thank you.
No, no, no. You know what the master will do if he finds him here. I demand that you stop right there. Oh, no, no, no. Not the master's chair. I'm not seeing this. I am not seeing this.
Cogsworth, the mantel clock, became even more distressed when the teapot rolled over on a cart and a cute little cup hopped into Maurice's hand.
How would you like a nice pot of tea, sir? It'll warm you up in no time.
No, no tea. No tea.
His mustache tickles, Mama.
Oh, hello.
Uh-oh.
There's a stranger here.
Master, allow me to explain. The gentleman was lost in the woods. He was cold and wet, so...
Master, I'd like to take this moment to say I was against this from the start.
Maurice cowered in the chair. At first he saw only a huge, hulking figure in the shadows. But then, the beast. A creature so horrifying that Maurice could not move or blink.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
I was lost in the woods and...
You're not welcome here.
I'm sorry.
What are you staring at?
Nothing.
So, you've come to stare at the beast, have you?
Please, I meant no harm. I just needed a place to stay.
I'll give you a place to stay.
No, no, please. No, no!
The huge creature grabbed Maurice and dragged him away. Back in the village, Gaston was planning to trap Belle. He promised the townspeople that he would marry her that very afternoon, and they followed him to Belle's cottage. With Le Fou ready to strike up the ban, Gaston puffed out his chest, then pounded on the door.
Gaston, what a pleasant surprise.
Isn't it, though? I'm just full of surprises. You know, Belle, there's not a girl in town who wouldn't love to be in your shoes. This is the day your dreams come true.
What do you know about my dreams, Gaston?
Plenty. Here, picture this. A rustic hunting lodge, my latest kill roasting on the fire, and my little wife massaging my feet, while the little ones play on the floor with the dogs. We'll have 6 or 7.
Dogs?
No, Belle. Strapping boys like me.
Imagine that.
And you know who that little wife will be?
Let me think.
You, Belle.
Gaston, I'm speechless. I really don't know what to say.
say you'll marry me.
I'm very sorry, Gaston, but I just don't deserve you.
Belle shut the door, and after waiting for everyone to disappear, she hurried outside to feed the chickens. She heard a familiar whinny, then saw Philippe stagger down the road.
Philippe, what are you doing here? Where's Papa? Where is he, Philippe? What happened? Oh, we have to find him. You have to take me to him.
Belle leaped astride, and although Philippe was exhausted, he turned around and carried her past the village into the murky forest where the castle loomed. After Belle forced her way through the gates, she saw her father's hat on the ground. She snatched it up and hurried into the castle, not caring whether anyone tried to stop her. No one appeared. She ran down a long corridor, then up a curved staircase. As she dashed down another hallway, Lumiere and Cogsworth saw her.
Papa? Are you here?
It's a girl!
I know it's a girl.
Don't you see? She's the one, the girl we have been waiting for. She has come to break the spell.
Wait a minute.
At the top of a stone staircase, Belle heard a faint voice.
Belle?
Papa?
Belle ran down a row of locked doors until she saw her father's face through a small slot. He thrust a frail hand out, and Belle grasped it.
Oh, your hands are like ice. We have to get you out of there.
Belle, I want you to leave this place.
Who's done this to you?
No time to explain. You must go, now.
I won't leave you.
What are you doing here? Run, Belle!
She spun around and glimpsed a dark figure retreating into the shadows.
Who's there? Who are you?
Master of this castle.
I've come for my father. Please, let him out. Can't you see he's sick?
Then he shouldn't have trespassed here.
But he could die. Please, I'll do anything.
There's nothing you can do.
Oh, there must be some way I can... Wait! Take me instead.
You. You would take his place?
No, no! You don't know what you're doing!
If I did, would you let him go?
Yes. You must promise to stay here forever.
Come into the light.
The beast stepped forward, and Belle turned away, repulsed by the hideous sight. Then she thought of her father and faced the beast.
You have my word.
Done!
Quickly, the beast hauled Maurice out of the castle to a vehicle that would return him to the village. Then the beast hurried upstairs, where he found Belle crumpled on the floor, weeping.
You didn't even let me say goodbye. I'll never see him again. And I didn't get to say goodbye.
The beast led Belle to her room. On the way, he grabbed Lumiere, the candelabra.
Say something to her.
I hope you like it here. The castle is your home now, so you can go anywhere you like, except the West Wing.
What's in the West Wing?
It's forbidden!
Back in the village, in his favorite tavern, Gaston glanced up to see the fawning LeFou.
Who does she think she is? That girl has tangled with the wrong man. No one says no to Gaston.
Darn right.
Dismissed, rejected, publicly humiliated. Why, it's more than I can bear.
More beer?
What for? Nothing helps. I'm disgraced.
Who, you? Never. Gaston, you've got to pull yourself together.
The door burst open, and in walked a soaked, wild-eyed Maurice.
Help! Someone help me!
Maurice?
Please, please, I need your help. He's got her locked in the dungeon.
Who?
Belle, we must go. Not a minute to lose.
Whoa, slow down, Maurice. Who's got Belle locked in a dungeon?
A beast! A horrible, monstrous beast!
Is it a big beast, you?
With a long, ugly snout?
Hideously ugly.
And sharp, cruel fangs?
Yes, yes. Will you help me?
All right, old man. We'll help you out.
You will? Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Oh!
Gaston tossed Maurice out of the tavern, much to the villagers' delight.
Crazy old Maurice. He's always good for a laugh.
Crazy old Maurice, Crazy old Maurice.
in the Beast Castle, Belle heard a light rap at the door. She answered it, and was just as surprised as her father had been to see a cheery teapot and some cups smiling up at her.
Told you she was pretty, Mama, didn't I?
All right, Chip, now that'll do.
As Belle sipped out of the chip cup, Mrs. Potts watched her.
That was a very brave thing you did, my dear.
But I've lost my father, my dreams, everything.
Cheer up, child. It'll turn out all right in the end. You'll see. Oh, listen to me. Jabbering on while there's a supper to get on the table. Chip.
Bye.
That night, the Beast paced in the dining room, waiting for Belle to appear for dinner. Mrs. Potts and Lumiere peered down from the mantel.
Master, have you thought that perhaps this girl could be the one to break the spell?
Of course I have. I'm not a fool.
Good. So, you fall in love with her, she falls in love with you, and poof, the spell is broken. We'll be human again by midnight.
Oh, it's not that easy, Lumiere. These things take time.
But the rose has already begun to wilt.
It's no use. She's so beautiful, and... Well, look at me!
In haste, Lumiere and Mrs. Potts coached the Beast, telling him to be debonair, yet friendly, witty, yet gentle, complimentary, sincere, and to never, ever lose his temper. But when Cogsworth arrived without Belle, the Beast stormed up to her room enraged.
I thought I told you to come down to dinner.
I'm not hungry.
You'll come out, or I'll break down the door.
Gently, gently.
Will you come down to dinner?
No.
Suave, genteel.
It would give me great pleasure if you would join me for dinner. Please.
No, thank you.
You can't stay in there forever.
Yes, I can.
Fine. Go ahead and starve! If she doesn't eat with me, then she doesn't eat at all.
The Beast stumped off to his lair, and as he watched another petal fall from the rose, he despaired of ever breaking the spell. With the Beast gone, Belle crept down to the kitchen. Cogsworth fumed when Lumiere led Belle into the dining room.
If the master finds out about this, it will be our neck.
Of course, of course. But what is dinner without a little music?
Music?
Ma chère mademoiselle, it is with deepest pride and greatest pleasure that we welcome you tonight. And now, we invite you to relax, let us pull up a chair, as the dining room proudly presents... your dinner. Be our guest. Be our guest. Put our service to the test. Tie your napkin round your neck, sherry, and we provide the rest. Soup du jour, hot hors d'oeuvre. Why, we only live to serve. Try the gray stuff. It's delicious. Don't believe me? Ask the dishes. They can sing, they can dance. After all, miss, this is France. And a dinner here is never second best. Go on, unfold your menu, take a glance, and then you'll be our guest. We our guest, be our guest. Beef bread, cheese souffle, pie and pudding on flambé. We'll prepare and serve with flair a culinary cabaret. You're alone and you're scared, but the banquet's all prepared. No one's gloomy or complaining while the flatware's entertaining. We tell jokes, I do tricks with my fellow candlesticks.
Put it all in perfect taste that you can bear.
Come on and lift your glass, you want your own free pass to be our guest.
If you're stressed, it's fine dining we suggest.
Be our guest, be our guest, be our guest.
She'll want tea, and my dear, that's fine with me. While the cups do their sauce-chewing, I'll be bubbling, I'll be brewing. I'll get warm, I'll be hot. For goodness sake, is that a spot? Clean it up, we want the company impressed. We've got a lot to do. Is it one
wonderful.
After the thrilling performance, Belle convinced Cogsworth to take her on a tour. When they reached a musty, darkened staircase, both Cogsworth and Lumiere stood in her way.
What's up there?
Where? There? Oh, nothing. Absolutely nothing of interest at all in the West Wing. Dusty, dull, very boring.
Ah, so that's the West Wing.
Oh, nice going.
I wonder what he's hiding up there.
Hiding? The master is hiding nothing.
Then it wouldn't be forbidden.
Cogsworth lured Belle away by promising to show her the library. As her host skipped ahead of her, Belle trailed further and further behind, then turned and ran back to the West Wing. Determined, she flew up the staircase and pushed open a door. Stepping inside, she gazed with fright and fascination at the dank, filthy room strewn with broken furniture and grey, gnawed bones, splintered mirrors, skewed portraits, shredded curtains and clothing, and a torn carpet lined with creeping vines. By the window stood the only life in the beast's lair, a rose shimmering beneath a glass dome. Entranced, Belle edged closer, then lifted the bell jar, and as she reached out to touch one velvet petal, the beast appeared.
Why did you come here?
I'm sorry.
Warned you never to come here.
I didn't mean any harm.
Do you realize what you could have done?
Please, stop.
Get out! Get out!
Terrified, Belle fled from the castle into the cold winter night. She found Philippe, and they galloped through the snow deeper and deeper into the forest. There they encountered another type of beast. Wolves, hungry and vicious, threatening Philippe. Belle clung to the horse's neck as he raced through the woods. When a wolf nipped at his heels, Philippe reared, throwing Belle to the ground. His rein caught on a branch, and as the wolves closed in on him, Belle grabbed a stick and ran toward his attackers. The wolves turned, snarling. Belle stumbled over a root and fell. A wolf leaped for her throat. Suddenly, a large paw ripped the animal off her. It was the beast. In horror, Belle watched as the wolves swarmed over him, snapping and biting. The beast fought back, and with a ferocious howl, flung the largest wolf through the air, and it slammed into a tree. The other wolves backed off into the woods. Grimacing with pain, the beast fell to the ground. Now was Belle's chance to escape. She gazed down the forest path, then back at the wounded beast. She could not abandon him. With Belle's help, the beast leaned against Philippe, and they returned to the castle. There, Belle found some rags and gently cleaned the beast's wounds.
Just hold still.
That hurts!
If you'd hold still, it wouldn't hurt as much.
Well, if you hadn't have run away, this wouldn't have happened.
If you hadn't frightened me, I wouldn't have run away.
Well, you shouldn't have been in the West Wing.
Well, you should learn to control your temper. Now hold still. This might sting a little. By the way, thank you for saving my life.
You're welcome.
While Belle had decided to stay with the beast, both her father and Gaston were making choices of their own. Maurice planned to rescue Belle by himself, and Gaston schemed to have the inventor committed to an asylum unless Belle agreed to marry him. Neither of them could imagine how Belle was being treated by the beast, who was doing all he could to please her.
Belle, there's something I want to show you. But first, you have to close your eyes. It's a surprise.
Can I open them?
No, not yet.
Now can I open them?
All right. Now.
Oh, I can't believe it. I've never seen so many books in all my life.
You like it?
It's wonderful.
Then it's yours.
Oh, thank you so much.
Delighted with the library, Belle took down a book and began reading. The following day at breakfast, the beast did his best to be polite, and awkwardly ate with a spoon. A little while later, Belle and the beast ventured into the snow. When he crouched to feed some birds, Belle smiled to herself. The beast looked like a different creature, with the cardinals eating out of his paws. That night, Belle read to the beast, while Lumiere and the others looked on. Later in the beast's lair, Lumiere gazed anxiously at the drooping rose.
You don't have time to be timid. You must be bold, daring, bold, daring. There will be music, romantic candlelight, provided by myself. And when the moment is right, you confess your love.
No, I can't.
You care for the girl, don't you?
More than anything.
Well then, you must tell her.
That night, Belle wore a gown of shimmering gold, and the beast looked handsome in his waistcoat and trousers. As they danced in the ballroom, Mrs. Potts watched them wistfully. Later, on the balcony, the beast approached Belle.
Belle, are you happy here with me?
Yes.
What is it?
If only I could see my father again, just for a moment. I miss him so much.
There is a way.
The beast took her to his lair and handed her the enchanted mirror. At first, Belle saw only her own reflection. Then she saw her father, stumbling through the woods, weak and weary from searching for her. The beast saw the anguish on Belle's face and ignored the withering rose.
You must go to him.
What did you say?
I release you. You're no longer my prisoner.
You mean I'm free?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Hold on, Papa. I'm on my way.
Before Belle hurried away, the beast gave her the enchanted mirror.
Take it with you, so you'll always have a way to look back and remember me.
Thank you for understanding how much he needs me.
Heartbroken, the beast watched her ride away from the castle. Then he turned his gaze to the rising moon. In the forest, Belle searched among the trees until she found her father, shivering and feverish on the ground. She helped him onto Philippe, and they galloped back to their cottage. As Belle helped her father inside, Le Fou saw them and dashed off to tell Gaston. At home, Belle tended to her father.
I thought I'd never see you again.
I missed you so much.
But the beast, how did you escape?
I didn't escape, Papa. He let me go.
That horrible beast?
But he's different now, Papa. He's changed somehow.
Belle opened the door and faced a tall, thin man cloaked in black. Behind him, Belle saw a wagon with barred windows and a mob approaching the cottage.
May I help you?
I've come to collect your father.
My father?
Don't worry, mademoiselle. We'll take good care of him.
My father's not crazy.
He was raving like a lunatic. We all heard him, didn't we?
No, I won't let you.
Maurice, tell us again, old man. Just how big was the beast?
He was enormous. I'd say at least 8. No, more like 10 feet.
Well, you don't get much crazier than that.
It's true, I tell you.
As Le Fou egged on the crowd, Gaston emerged from the shadows and put his arm around Belle.
I might be able to clear up this little misunderstanding. If
what?
If you marry me.
What?
One little word, Belle, that's all it takes.
Never.
Have it your way.
Belle! Let go of me!
Distraught, Belle pushed Gaston away and ran inside to find the enchanted mirror. When she returned, she held it up for the crowd to see.
My father's not crazy, and I can prove it. Show me the beast.
The mirror shimmered, and an image of the beast appeared.
Is he dangerous? Oh, no, he'd never hurt anyone. Please, I know he looks vicious, but he's really kind and gentle. He's my friend.
If I didn't know better, I'd think you had feelings for this monster.
He's no monster, Gaston. You are.
Furious, Gaston grabbed the mirror away from Bill.
The beast will make off with your children. He'll come after them in the night.
No.
We're not safe till his head is mounted on my wall. I say we kill the beast.
We're not safe until he's dead. He'll come stalking us at night.
Set to sacrifice our children to his monstrous appetite.
He'll wreak havoc on our village if we let him wander free. So it's time to take some action, boys. It's time to follow me. Through the mist, through the woods, through the darkness and the shadows. It's a nightmare, but it's one exciting ride. Say a prayer, then we're there at the drawbridge of a castle, and there's something truly terrible inside. It's a beast. He's got fangs, razor sharp ones, massive paws, killer claws for the beast. Hear him roar, see him foam, but we're not coming home till he's dead. Good and dead! Kill the beast!
No, I won't let you do this.
If you're not with us, you're against us. Bring the old man.
Get your hands off me.
We can't have them running off to warn the creature.
Let us out!
We'll rid the village of this beast. Who's with me?
Fire!
Fire!
Out your torch, out your horse.
Through your courage to the sticking place.
We're counting on Gaston to lead the way. Through a mist, to a wood, where within a haunted castle something's lurking that you don't see every day. It's a beast, one as tall as a mountain. We will press till he's good and deceased. Sally forth, sally ho, grab your sword, grab your bow, raise the load and here we go.
We'll lay siege to the castle and bring back his head.
We have to warn the beast. This is all my fault. Oh, Papa, what are we going to do?
No. We'll think of something.
Meanwhile, Gaston led the villagers to the castle.
We don't like what we don't understand. It kind of scares us, and this monster is mysterious and beast. Bring your guns, bring your knives, save your children, and your wives will save our village and our lives. We'll kill the beast!
I knew it. I knew it was foolish to get our hopes up.
Maybe it would have been better if she'd never come at all. Could it be?
Is it
she? Sacre bleu! Invaders!
Encroachers!
And my lord, the mirror!
Warn the master. If it's a fight they want, we'll be ready for them. Who's with me?
Take whatever booty you can find. But remember, the beast is mine!
Hearts of flame, standards high, people marching into battle on the cradle of the danger just increased. Raise the flag, raise the foam, every cover, every strong, every defense, and every ball!
Pardon me, Master.
Leave me in peace.
But, sir, the castle is under attack.
Kill the beast! Kill the beast!
What should we do, Master?
It doesn't matter now. Just let them come.
Kill the beast! Kill the beast! Kill the beast!
As soon as the mob crashed inside, the objects attacked. They ducked and they lunged, and Cogsworth slid down the banister to save Lumiere from the fool. Mrs. Potts and her children poured scalding water on their victims, and a wardrobe fought with flying drawers and doors. When knives and the stove entered the fight, the villagers shrieked and ran for their lives. Only Gaston wasn't among them. He had found the beast brooding in his lair. The vicious hunter shot an arrow into the beast's shoulder, and when he fell, booted him onto the balcony.
Get up! Get up! What's the matter, beast? Too kind and gentle to fight back.
No!
Belle.
No! Gaston, don't!
Belle and her father had been rescued by Chip, who had stowed away when Belle left the castle. The little teacup had fired up Maurice's invention and sent it crashing through the cottage door. Now Belle and Maurice stared in horror as Gaston bore down on his prey. But hearing Belle's voice had renewed the strength of the beast, and his huge paw grabbed the club in Gaston's hands. The beast forced the club back and rose, towering over Gaston. The two grappled on the rooftop until finally the beast lifted the hunter high above his head, preparing to destroy him. But he could not do it. His love for Belle had taught him how to be human, and it was Gaston who had become the monster. The beast dropped Gaston, and as he reached for Belle, Gaston stabbed him in the back. Roaring in pain, the beast reared up, and the cowardly Gaston took a step backward, tumbling to his death. The beast collapsed, and Belle ran to him.
You came back.
Of course I came back. I couldn't let them... Oh, this is all my fault. If only I'd gotten here sooner.
Maybe. It's better. It's better this way.
Don't talk like that. You'll be all right. We're together now. Everything's going to be fine, you'll see.
And at least... I got to see you one last time.
No, no. Please, please, please don't leave me. I love you. I love you.
As Belle leaned down to kiss the beast, she did not see the last rose petal fall. Started to shimmer with magic. She looked up and saw the rain transform into fairy dust and the beast into a human. The prince rose and held out his hands to her.
Belle, it's me.
It is you.
The rose burst into full bloom, and as Belle and the prince embraced, the objects glowed with enchantment. Lumiere became his old dashing self, a smooth and suave maitre d'. Mrs. Potts changed into a plump, sweet-faced cook. Cogsworth, a rotund major domo.
Lumiere? Cogsworth? Oh, Mrs. Potts! Look at us!
Amazed, Belle's father stared at the transformations taking place around him. Feather dusters, brooms, a stove, and furniture were all becoming human again. The mist lifted from the forest, and dawn silhouetted the trees. And on the table, the little teacup who had saved them became a young boy with a chipped tooth, and a wonderful, joyful smile which spoke for them all.